long ago. Remember, filled with everything you know. Remember, when you're sad and feeling down. Remember, turn around. Remember, life is just a memory. Remember, close your eyes and you can see. Remember, think of all that life can be. Remember.
These white American pelicans make their nests on islands located in small lakes of the Canadian prairies. Each day they fly from their nesting sites to places where they catch fish, which they will take back to their nesting sites to feed their young. Not only do these pelicans have to know the location of their fishing and nesting sites, they have to learn a migration route from their summer home in Canada to their winter home in the southern United States. Spatial memory for where things are located and the routes of migration are two important spatial abilities of most animals. A remarkable feat of spatial memory is displayed by the black-capped chickadee. This small bird is able to store thousands of sunflower seeds in different places in the barks of trees and subsequently to accurately retrieve each seed. Because chickadees live in the mountains and do not migrate, this is a useful strategy of storing food for winter. How do animals acquire spatial memories, and how do they find their way through fields, forests, and on long migratory journeys? In 1978, John O'Keefe and Lynn Nadell proposed in their book, The Hippocampus as a Cognitive Map, that a brain region called the hippocampus creates a map for each environment an animal enters. Later, the animal uses its brain map to locate things in its environment and to travel from one place to another in that environment. These Richardson's ground squirrels live in large colonies or towns. There are numerous entrances to the various tunnels, and the tunnels may be spread over acres of territory. A single squirrel's daily meanderings may take it a long way from its home burrow. First, the brain map tells the squirrel where its burrow is located, even though it may not be able to see it. Second, the brain map tells the squirrel the shortest route back to its burrow, so that it can run directly home when it is in danger. If it enters the wrong burrow, it will be attacked and expelled by the owner. How is a brain map formed? O'Keefe and Adele propose that an animal starts with a blank map for each new environment that it enters. The details of the map are filled in as the animal explores the new environment. When these kittens explore a new environment, they learn what objects are located there, how far the objects are from each other, and they also learn how long it will take to move from one object to another. Exploration is therefore the first important step in forming a brain map. There are two sources of information that an animal can use to form a brain map. The first kind of information concerns objects. This horse, living in the foothills of the Canadian Rockies, has a map that represents objects in its surroundings. Some trees in the corner of the field, a barn and a house, and, of course, the Canadian Rocky Mountains. By moving around in its environment, the horse learns that some objects are closer and some are further away. Its own movements produce the second kind of navigation that an animal can use to form a brain map. Stimulation from receptors on the skin, in muscles and tendons, and stimulation from balance systems of the middle ear all provide information about the distance and direction of movements. A copy of the commands used to produce movement called efference copy, also provides information about the distance and direction of movement. Finally, sensory flow, such as visual flow, which occurs during movement, provides information about the distance and direction of movement. If these various kinds of information are integrated, they can tell an animal the distance and direction back to a starting point. This kind of spatial information is commonly referred to as sense of direction and sense of distance. There are numerous kinds of allophetic cues. They include visual objects, sounds, odors, polarized light, wind currents, and so forth. For most mammals, the allophetic cues usually used for navigating and for locating places are visual cues. Animals use allophetic information for two different kinds of navigation. The first kind of navigation, called place navigation, involves learning the location of a place in relation to a variety of other cues.